All right, I think we're ready. I would like to introduce our Executive Director, Lisa Funderburke Hoffman.
Hi, thank you, Miranda. It's wonderful to see all of you on Zoom today. And I wanna thank you, Miranda, for partnering with our team and the National Endowment for the Arts and hosting this webinar today. We're really excited to get started. As Miranda mentioned, I am Lisa Funderburke Hoffman, Executive Director of the Alliance of Artist Communities. I'm calling in from Providence, Rhode Island, the sacred lands of the Narragansett, Wampanoag, and Niantic. I acknowledge the truth that the United States land seizures and colonization of Providence were a project of physical and spiritual destruction that denied the Narragansett and Wampanoag peoples free and unhindered access to the land that fundamentally shapes their identity and spirituality. We pay respects to the Narragansett, Niantic, and Wampanoag peoples, both past and present. And I encourage each of you to consider the legacies of violence, displacement, and settlement that bring us together in each of our places today. We acknowledge the past, present, and future generations of the nations who have stewarded this land, as well as honor and celebrate this place. Thank you. Thank you. Once again, want to say thank you all for joining us today. This is a wonderful time to come together and share a little bit of information and talk a little bit about some things that are on the horizon with National Endowment for the Arts. Before we get started, I want to just share a few of our rules of engagement. If you have participated before, you understand our community agreements. If this is your first time, we always try to operate from a place of care. We want to be respectful of the valuable commodity of time, so we're going to ask that you please honor the space by keeping your audio on mute and respecting engagement in the chat box. We have a very focused topic here, so if you're invited to speak or have an opportunity to share a specific question, we ask that you stay on line with what we're discussing here today. Keep the specific topics in mind. We're going to do our best on this end as presenters and facilitators to avoid alphabet soup and coded language by unpacking acronyms and buzzwords. We ask the same that you do the same when you're presenting questions. And again, practice chat box etiquette. Use the private chat function if you have a colleague in the room that you're trying to connect with. But we do want to reduce the chatter in the chat box and reserve it strictly for questions for National Endowment for the Arts today, just to keep us all focused and make the most use of the time that we have here today. Over the course of the past 5 years, I think one of the things that we've been trying to impart to the artist community's fields is the importance of sustaining and nurturing your relationships with funders and donors. We talk about the long arc of that relationship, the value of it, and why it is important to stay together, stay with each other, to stay in close contact, to stay in close proximity. And this is yet another demonstration of how this shows up in our work. The Alliance of Artist Communities has enjoyed a long relationship with National Endowment for the Arts, and they have been incredible partners and advocates for the artist community's field and our work that we facilitate on a day-to-day basis. So this is yet another extension of that relationship and a partnership. And we couldn't be more excited to welcome our panelists here today to share with you some information that I know many of you are anxious to hear and learn about so that you can further in your inquiry into how you might engage more with National Endowment for the Arts, not only for the American Rescue Plan and COVID relief, but for other opportunities. So think of this as an extension of our collective work and our continued advocacy efforts. And we're going to try to keep this going. I feel very confident that the endowment fully understands what is important in terms of reaching out and connecting and sharing information and making that information as available, accessible, and transparent as possible. And we're hoping that over the course of this year that this will not be the last conversation, but this is the first of many. With that, I get to take a back seat and turn over the microphone to our presenters. And it's an honor and a privilege. The one thing I can say about working in this sector that over the past 10 years is that these relationships have only grown professionally and in a collegial way to think about not only how we advance as an organization, but how we get to know people. And then over the past year, I just have to say even more so, my colleagues at the National Endowment for the Arts have been really good at helping us remain hopeful in a time when hope seems hard to come by. So it's an honor and privilege to turn over this microphone and this platform to our colleagues. And I'd like to introduce you to Ra Joy. And Ra Joy is the Chief of Staff for the National Endowment of the Arts. And you all may remember Ra, back, I think it was in 2014, I met you at the Charleston, South Carolina conference, which is one of the better, like, amazing venues and places to host a conference. And it felt really, we had a great attendance, but it also felt really intimate. And I'm particularly love to show that 2014, and here we are in 2021, continuing with this work and communicating with this field and thinking about how we could do our collective work better. So it's my honor and privilege to turn it over to Ra, who's going to open us up and bring the team forward and share some information with you all. So thank you, Ra. Thank you for joining us today, and welcome, and welcome.
Thank you, Lisa. You have a wonderful memory. And hello, everybody. My name is Ra Joy. My pronouns are he, him. I serve as Chief of Staff at the National Endowment for the Arts. And I'm really honored to help welcome you to today's gathering on the NEA's American Rescue Plan Funds. At a time of enormous consequence for our country, and at a time when we all need what art brings us, we really appreciate you making time to participate in today's interactive session. I want to start by thanking Lisa Hoffman and the entire team at the Alliance of Artist Communities, not just for co-hosting today's session, but for all that you do to advance creativity, to lift up artists, and to support artist communities. I think we can go back one slide. I want to start, I know that many of you are new to the agency. At least that's perhaps what the instant poll suggests. But building upon the Arts Endowment's legacy of success and service to the field, I did want to start by just saying a few words about some of the overarching priorities of the agency and how we're working to meet the pressing needs of our time. There are four overarching themes that I just want to allude to before we dig a little bit deeper into the American Rescue Plan. The first is all about rebuilding the creative economy. You're going to hear a lot about that today. That is really about reversing the damage of COVID-19 and getting creative workers back to work. A second focus area for us is around the power of culture and creative expression to help usher in a healthier and more hopeful future. The Arts Endowment is proud to maintain a portfolio of initiatives at the intersection of the arts, healing, and public health. We're increasingly focused on ways that cultural organizations can help reopen safely and successfully, as well as to help build vaccine confidence in communities that have been hardest hit by COVID-19. A third focus area for the agency is all about advancing equity, access, and justice. And this is really about the role that culture and creative expression plays in illuminating urgent issues of racial justice, social justice, and environmental justice. This is really about the power of the arts to animate the idea of liberty and justice for all. On day one of his administration, President Biden issued a directive, an executive order, directing all U.S. departments and agencies to conduct a racial equity assessment within the first 200 days. So I've had August 8th circled in red on my calendar for a long time because it's just around the corner, and that's the date by which we'll be submitting our homework to Secretary Rice and the Domestic Policy Council and the agency's racial equity assessment. Our fourth focus area is really about serving the field and strengthening our capacity and ability to support our diverse arts ecosystem. As many of you know well, the Arts Endowment maintains a network of relationships with local, state, and regional arts agencies, and we're really mindful about how we can continue to build that muscle, particularly at this time in our country's history. We know that above all, there can be no pandemic recovery without culture and the arts. And perhaps this is a good point to pivot to talk a little bit more intentionally about the American Rescue Plan. So perhaps we can go to the next slide. So we know that putting an end to the pandemic means getting creative workers back to work. Before the pandemic hit, the cultural sector was approaching a $1 trillion industry that directly employed 5.2 million workers and indirectly supported millions more. Chances are, if you're zooming into today's session, you know firsthand that few sectors of our economy, if any, have been hit harder by COVID-19 than the arts. Cultural organizations were among the first businesses to close their doors when the pandemic hit, and they'll be among the last to truly fully reopen. On March 11th, President Biden signed into law the American Rescue Plan Act of 2021. It's the second largest stimulus package in legislative history. And we're grateful to the president and to Congress that this relief package includes resources to help arts organizations and arts workers hard hit by COVID-19. This includes $135 million for the National Endowment for the Arts. You're going to hear a lot about our ARP program or ARP program. Before we jump into ARP, though, I do want to go back to the last slide and just mention this timely issue of housing. We know that artist housing is another form of affordable housing. We know that the CDC issued a moratorium on evictions, and that moratorium on evictions is coming to a close at the end of July. And we are working hard to raise awareness about resources that are available in the American Rescue Plan, including $21.6 billion in emergency rental assistance. And we really want to use every opportunity we have now going into August to encourage folks, both renters and landlords, to check out those resources that are designed to help keep people in their homes. In terms of our direct support to the arts field, next slide, please. I do want to say a little bit about our ARP program and the design of that program and what's unique about the NEA's American Rescue Plan funds. And first and foremost, I want to emphasize that our overarching goal with the American Rescue Plan is to support relief and recovery efforts for arts organizations and the artists they employ all across the country. Our goal is to help preserve jobs and assist arts organizations as they rehire and reopen. Second overarching goal for our program is to expand access to funds for communities that have been historically underserved and underrepresented by government. You'll see here on the left-hand side of this slide, on April 29th, the Arts Endowment announced the distribution of approximately $52 million in ARP funds to state and regional arts agencies so that they could begin distributing resources to impacted arts organizations in their jurisdictions. On the right-hand side of this slide, you'll see that on June 23rd, the Arts Endowment announced two new grant programs to deploy approximately $80 million in American Rescue Plan funds. There's one program you'll hear a lot about today, which is a direct program to support nonprofit arts and cultural organizations. We also have a program to provide local arts agencies with sub-granting resources. Next slide, please. So I want to start by saying that we believe that the best way to learn is by listening. And we spent the last several months meeting with and listening to leaders all throughout the cultural sector, arts administrators, artists, creators, leaders from arts agencies and service organizations. And when we met, we specifically asked for feedback on the agency's last stimulus package, the CARES Act of 2020. And we asked for feedback on what worked and what could be improved. And time again, a consistent theme that we heard is a call to embed fairness and equity, both in the program design and in every phase of the funding lifecycle. And so before I turn it over to my colleagues at the NEA, I want to draw your attention to the very left-hand column of this slide around program structure. And there are a few things that are unique to ARP. The first is wider eligibility. And so we really want to open the doors of opportunity even further to groups that perhaps have never received a grant from the Arts Endowment in the past, or perhaps have never received a grant from the federal government. We're making an intentional effort to have wider eligibility. Building on what worked from CARES, we also want to ensure that there's flexibility with the funds themselves. So these resources are intended to help support general operating expenses. There is no matching grant requirement for our ARP program. A third distinction is around locals and the role that local arts agencies play in our arts ecosystem. And so we feel like a great way to make the recovery both a national effort and a bottom-up effort is to support the subgranting capability of local arts councils, arts commissions, and departments of cultural affairs all across the country. So in addition to what you learned today about our direct grants to arts organizations, we also encourage you to keep an eye out for ARP resources that may be available at the state or local level in your community. Now that the guidelines have posted, our primary focus is to help get dollars out the door to nonprofit theaters, museums, dance companies, cultural organizations, large and small. And next slide, please. To help take you on a deeper dive on ARP and to introduce the our team, I'm going to hand it over momentarily to one of my colleagues. But I do want to say that every chance I get, I tell people that the Arts Endowment has the most knowledgeable, accessible staff team in the country. And it's my pleasure at this point. The mic was passed to me, and now I'm pleased to pass it to Brandon Gryde, who will introduce the other members of our team and lead you on a deeper dive on our American Rescue Plan program. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Ra, and I'm so glad that you had the opportunity to join us here for the Alliance of Artist Communities webinar, and had a chance to introduce you to all the folks on the call, folks who might not have met you before. And my name is Brandon Gryde. I use he, him. I'm the NEA's Director of Presenting and Multidisciplinary Works and Artist Communities. And I'm joined by Jennie Terman, Presenting and Multidisciplinary Works and Artist Communities Specialist. We're so thrilled that you've joined us, and especially want to welcome anyone who is thinking about applying for an NEA grant for the first time. So there will be a lot of time for questions at the end of the presentation, and we'll try to move relatively speedily through our presentation. But feel free to type any questions in the chat area, and we'll get through as many as possible today. We also have our contact information here if you have any additional questions, and we'll share our ARP hotline contact information as well throughout this presentation. So if you remember one thing from this webinar, I hope it's this. We understand that applying for federal funding and managing a grant can be a significant undertaking. And we strive to ensure that all applicants receive the support they need throughout the process. And we welcome the opportunity to connect with you. The National Endowment for the Arts is an independent federal agency. We provide funding for the arts in all 50 states, DC, and US territories. Each year, we award thousands of grants to provide all Americans with diverse opportunities for arts participation. So please check out the grant section of our website, arts.gov, for a listing of our regular grant programs, and don't hesitate to reach out with any questions. We encourage you to learn about these other grant programs and look forward to supporting you throughout the process. As Ron mentioned, the American Rescue Plan is designed to fuel the nation's recovery from the devastating economic and health effects of the COVID-19 pandemic. Funds allocated to the NEA in this historic legislation represent a significant commitment to the arts and a recognition of the value of the arts and culture sector to the nation's economy and recovery. Rescue Plan funding is available through two separate competitive opportunities: grants to organizations, which is what we'll focus on today, and grants to local arts agencies for subgranting. And that those deadlines are happening right now. I think part one was just due in the most recent week. So a special note, if there are any local arts agencies tuning in, if you've already submitted your application for part one, you can only apply for one of the two opportunities. If you did not submit to the part one of for the local arts agencies, you can submit to the grants to organizations. And I would check in with the through the ARP hotline if you have any questions about that. So the grants to organizations program will be carried out through one-time grants to eligible organizations to support their own operations. Unlike other NEA funding programs that offer project-based support, rescue plan funds are intended to support day-to-day business expenses or operating costs and not specific programmatic activities. Applicants must be nonprofit, tax-exempt 501c3 U.S. organizations, units of state or local government, or federally recognized tribal communities or tribes. Applicants may include, but are not limited to, arts organizations, local arts agencies, arts service organizations, and other eligible organizations. We do not fund direct grants to individuals. The applicant organization must have completed a 3-year history of arts programming prior to August 12, 2021. For the purpose of defining eligibility, 3-year history refers to when an organization began its programming and not when it was incorporated or received nonprofit tax-exempt status. Programming is not required to have taken place during consecutive years. And if your programming has been disrupted due to COVID, there are flexibilities described in the guidelines. Applicants must also be up to date with reporting requirements for any previous NEA grants. As Ron mentioned, we are committed to diversity, equity, inclusion, and fostering mutual respect for diverse beliefs and values. We intend to make awards that will impact a broad constituency. We encourage applications from a variety of eligible organizations, including organizations that serve populations that are underserved, such as those whose opportunities to experience the arts are limited by ethnicity, economics, geography, or disability, organizations with small and medium-sized budgets, organizations from rural to urban communities, and organizations that may be applying for federal support through the NEA for the first time. And now I will turn it over to Jennie.
Thanks, Brandon. Hi, everyone. Nice to see everybody. I'm Jennie Terman, and I'll continue the presentation. Organizations may submit only one application to this program. Exceptions to the one application rule are made only for parent organizations applying on behalf of one or more separately identifiable and independent components. Eligible organizations that receive CARES Act funding from the NEA may apply to this program as long as there are no overlapping costs during the same grant period. Eligible local arts agencies may either apply to the Rescue Plans grants to local arts agencies for a subgranting program or to this program for general operating support, but not both. You may apply to other NEA funding opportunities for which your organization is eligible, including grants for arts projects. In each case, the applications cannot have any overlap in costs during the same grant period. You may request a grant amount for $50,000, $100,000, or $150,000. Applications will be reviewed and considered for a recommendation only at one of these requested amounts, and the cost share or matching funds is not required. We encourage you to select a grant amount that is reflective of your organization's size and internal capacity. Applications will be reviewed and considered for recommendation at the requested amount only. Whichever amount you choose, keep in mind the review criteria when crafting your application to make the best case. Your application will be evaluated based on the capacity of your organization to carry out the proposal. A grant period of up to 2 years is allowed, and it may start no earlier than January 1st, 2022. Rescue plan funds are intended to support day-to-day business expenses or operating costs, and not specific programmatic activities. Please read the guidelines carefully for details about what costs we can support. Support is limited to any or all of the following: salary support, full or partial, for one or more staff positions, Rescue plan funds may be used to support existing jobs, new jobs, or to restore jobs that were furloughed or eliminated due to the pandemic. Fees, stipends for artists and or contractual personnel to support the services they provide for specific activities as part of the organizational operations. Artist fees or stipends should be related to work with a tangible outcome, such as performances, presentations, workshops, and or the creation of artwork. Also, facilities costs, such as mortgage principal, rent, and utilities. Costs associated with health and safety supplies for staff and or visitors or audiences. For example, personal protective equipment, cleaning supplies, hand sanitizer, et cetera. And finally, marketing and promotion costs. One type of cost isn't preferred over another. It's up to your organization to choose which cost to include in the budget and to make the case in the application as to why they're important in relation to the review criteria. Think about where the funds may make the most impact for your organization or fill a gap that is not currently being funded through other sources. All applications are reviewed by advisory panels made up of diverse groups of citizens from around the country. Panelists will consider the review criteria of artistic excellence and artistic merit, including the proposal's significance to the mission and core work of the organization, ability to carry out the award as shown by the alignment of the budget and other resources with the goals and requirements of the ARP funding opportunity, as appropriate, potential to have an immediate impact on the arts workforce, and as appropriate, the potential to serve and or reach individuals whose opportunities to experience the arts are limited by ethnicity, economics, geography, or disability. Panel recommendations are shared with the National Council on the Arts, which then makes recommendations to the Arts Endowment's chairman. The chairman reviews the council's recommendations and makes the final decision on all grant awards. Submitting an application is a multi-step process. For part one, you will submit to grants.gov the application for federal domestic assistance, also known as the short organization form. This is a brief form that will collect very basic information about your organization. For part two, you will fill out the grant application form in the NEA's applicant portal. This web form is where you'll enter the majority of your application material, for example, the proposal description and budget information. Grants.gov and the NEA's applicant portal are two separate online systems. In order to use grants.gov, you must first obtain a DUNS number from the Dun and Bradstreet, and then register with the System for Award Management, also known as SAM.gov. If you're a first-time applicant, start this process now. Allow at least 2 weeks for your SAM.gov registration or renewal. You'll also need to ensure that your organization is registered with grants.gov. As a reminder, SAM.gov and grants.gov are federal government systems, and registration in both systems is always free. The guidelines on our website have links to these sites, as well as links to video tutorials to help you get started. NEA staff does not have internal access to SAM or grants.gov, so if you run into technical difficulties with either entity, you should reach out to them directly via telephone or email. And now I'll pass it back to Brandon.
Thank you, Jennie. All right, so we anticipate a large number of applications for this funding opportunity. And because of that, applications will be submitted in two separate groups, one for organizations with legal names beginning with A through L versus one for organizations with legal names beginning with M through Z. The different submission windows will not affect the timing of grant review or your organization's ability to receive a grant. To determine which group applies to you, use your organization's legal name as it appears in the current IRS 501c3 status letter or in the official document that identifies your organization as a unit of state or local government or as a federally recognized tribal community. Do not use your organization's popular name if different. If you aren't sure which group to select, read the guidelines for some helpful tips or feel free to contact us. Both the A through L groups and the M through Z group will have the same Part 1 grants.gov deadline on August 12, 2021. Part 2 deadlines for the A through L group and the M through Z group will be different. So you'll see in the slide, the A through L will submit Part 2 during the window of August 19th through August 21st. And M through Z will submit Part 2 during the window of August 27th and September 2nd. And if you are, again, if you're unsure, please feel free to contact us. So I'll run through these fairly quickly because it's an opportunity to see how to navigate our website. So the guidelines are available on our website, arts.gov. Click on the menu button on the top right of the homepage and then click on grants. Next, scroll down to American Rescue Plan Grants and then select Grants to Organizations. Carefully read the program description and review the other links on the left side of the page for information such as eligibility requirements and application deadlines. And if you need to reach us, click on Contacts. To access the application instructions, go to the How to Apply page. Part 1 instructions will walk you through how to submit to grants.gov. Part 2 instructions will walk you through how to submit to NEA's applicant portal. Click on the link to the Part 2 PDF instructions. Even though you won't have access to the applicant portal until the dates we showed you before, all of the application questions are available now in this PDF, so you can prepare your application early. The PDF includes instructions for accessing the applicant portal. We encourage you to go to the applicant resources area in the guidelines. Technical assistance resources include FAQs, an application checklist, a summary of common application mistakes, a grant application form tutorial, grants.gov and sam.gov resources. Instructional videos that actually now include videos with ASL, and Spanish and Chinese interpretation. Signups for live online applicant Q&A sessions with our staff and many other items. So please feel free to check those out. The FAQ section on the website covers a lot of ground, but I want to highlight just a few frequently asked questions. Can I apply to ARP if I have already applied to another NEA grant this year or other federal relief funds such as the Shuttered Venue Operating Grants or PPP? And the answer is yes, you can. However, it's important to remember that you cannot use multiple federal grants to fund the same activities or costs. Each grant should be funding something different. Additionally, you can't use ARP or other federal funds in order to meet the matching requirement of other NEA grant programs, such as grants for arts projects. Are work samples required for ARP applications? And the answer is no, you will not be required or even asked to submit work samples or other support materials. Rescue plan funds are for specific general operating costs only. What is the difference between a project-based grant and a general operating grant? So while rescue plan funds may not support work that goes into programmatic activity, these grants are not project-based. In a project-based grant, all of the costs must relate to the execution of a specific project. In an operations-based grant, eligible costs are not tied to a specific project. For example, you may include staff salaries for your curatorial team, as well as artist fees and stipends for teaching artists in your education department, even if these people will not be working together on the same activities. Similarly, fees and stipends for artists and or contractual personnel must support the services they provide for specific activities as part of the organizational operations. So just a couple last minute tips before we get to your questions. If you aren't registered, I know we've said this multiple times now, but if you aren't registered with DUNS, SAM, or grants.gov, get started now. Late applications will not be accepted, so be sure that your application is complete and submitted on time. Submit Part 1 well in advance of the August 12th deadline to give yourself ample time to resolve any issues. Likewise, submit all of your Part 2 materials to the applicant portal well in advance of the deadline. The hours of heaviest usage are generally 8 p.m. to 11:59 p.m. Eastern Time on the day of the deadline, so avoid using the system at this time if possible. Each year we have applicants that wait until the last minute and unfortunately run out of time. So due to the volume of ARP questions, we've also set up specific ARP hotlines. Please use this contact information if you have any additional questions. And of course, if you have any questions regarding your FY22 Grants for Arts Projects applications, or are thinking about your FY23 application, please reach out to your appropriate specialist. And we can just stay on this slide. If you want, you can go back to the last slide just to give folks another couple seconds to be able to get those down. And I think we'll move to questions now. I'm not sure if I'm seeing them updated on the shared document.
Brandon, you'll have to do a refresh on your document. Yeah.
And Brandon, while we do that, can I throw a question out to you and Jennie right away?
Absolutely.
That came up for me. One of the things that was mentioned was about artist support and fees and stipends for artists. As we know, in the residency field, we provide most of our programs we subsidize the artist's participation in the program, but we are not tethered to a direct outcome for that artist. They're not often not expected to do a workshop or a presentation or anything along that nature. However, their presence is germane to the operation of our organizations. Mm-hmm. Can we still apply for artist fees and stipends? What is the delineation on that, or how would we categorize that to be successful?
I think as long as you're tying it to the operation of the organization, that should be fine. And I'll turn that to Jennie just to make sure that I'm not missing anything on that.
Yeah, I would agree with your assessment there, Brandon.
Okay, so you all heard that, and if you have any questions about that, make sure you hit that ARP hotline, because I think that is something that has come up again and again, at least for me personally, when I was running a residency. We have several questions here. Brandon and Jennie, are you able to see them?
I can see them, absolutely.
You want to just take them? I don't want to hold a lot of time sorting through them.
Sure thing. Yeah, absolutely. So first question is if we have an application into the NEA for this round with artist communities and submitted our annual program budget that included some salaries, stipends for artists, contract fees for program evaluation, marketing and communications, can we request funding for these same items in the ARP grant, and on what basis? Do they need to show an increase in salary and capacity, or can they just hold a line, or does the above instruction mean something else? So you include those requests in your ARP application as long as they're not overlapping with your current NEA grant request or current open NEA funds. So you want to make sure that even if you're requesting funds for the same artist or the same staff or your marketing, that those funds are going to two separate types of projects and or two separate streams of funding, and that there's just not an overlap. Jennie, do you want to add anything to that?
Nope, you got it.
All right.
I'll read the next question though. So next question is, can we use ARP funds to help cover scholarship support for artists to participate in our residency? Yes, that would fall under fees for artists. So that would be fine. But again, it has to be part of your general operating costs. So as long as you're able to tie those costs, your general operating costs, that's fine. All right.
Great.
Next question
is, can you define small and medium-sized budgets and also define rural? So we've left that open, actually, and that's really for each organization to self-define. We know that small and medium-sized budgets can mean really different things depending on what region of the country you're coming from. And so we don't have any specific guidelines for how to define those types of budgets. So that's really for that's a case for you to make in your own application, and we'll review those based upon how you define yourselves.
Brandon, can I ask for a clarification on that?
Yeah.
So is there a minimum budget that you have to apply? So if I've been in effect for, and my budget is $60,000 and I'm able to make it on that, but I'm asking for $50,000, yeah. Am I still eligible to apply?
Eligible to apply. We don't have any minimum budget or any maximum budget, even for our traditional grants for arts projects. So I think that's the helpful thing for folks to know, that a lot of these eligibility requirements really convey between both our traditional grant making processes and ARP. So even if you have a very small budget of less than $100,000, or if your budget is $10,000, $15,000, you can apply for even our traditional grants as well as our ARP grants.
Thank you.
All right, so the next question, can the grant period start after January 1st, 2022? The answer is yes. January 1st, 2022 is the earliest start date for these grants, but any period after that, I think we already mentioned the grant period can be for up to 2 years, but it can be any shorter period. So January 1st, 2022 and after is when the start date can be.
Great, thanks, Jennie. We have one question here. Can one apply for less than $50,000 in grants? And the answer is no. So we have the three set amounts of $50,000, $100,000, and $150,000. It's kind of an all or nothing request. So if you apply for $100,000, no one's going to be making a decision to give you the $50,000 amount. And so we really encourage you to make that decision based upon the capacity of your organization, what you think makes sense. Also, we anticipate our guesstimate is that we will probably be making about 800 grants to the field. And we're anticipating about, maybe about 8,000 applications. So, you just take that in mind. And if you have any questions about how your organization might fit into that, specifically for your organization, I would also recommend contacting the ARP hotline, because then you can talk through that process with someone on the hotline as well.
And Brandon, one clarification here. So when we say 8,000, we're anticipating about 8,000 applications from the field. We're talking about the arts sector writ large, right? Like it's the entire sector. So it's just not artist communities. We're talking about the entire arts sector. And then there are 800 applications being distributed across the sector.
Yeah, and that's a guesstimate number. I think based upon the volume that we saw with CARES Act and how much money we have available to us. So that's not a perfect number, but it's sort of what we publish online is what we estimate we might be able to distribute.
Okay, and one more clarification on that. In terms of thinking about estimating your capacity of your organization, would you advise us considering that capacity against time, right? So it's not only thinking about your budget in that year, but taking a long view over the arc of the 2 years, because this is our assumption right that this is a kind of one and done over this 2 year period. So it's not only thinking 2022, but the long view of 2023 too.
Absolutely. And as Jennie mentioned earlier, you can apply for up to 2 years or you can apply for, as little as 3 months for an implementation period. So you can take that into account that if you're going for a full 2 years of usage of the funds, it might make more sense to apply for a larger number. If you're applying for a shorter time frame, it might make more sense to go for a smaller number. And again, that might have to do with the capacity of the organization and the needs of each organization. But those are just a couple of the different factors that can come into play as you're making a decision.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, so I can go to the next question, which is, can the three-year program history qualification be expanded upon? I'm a little confused about the difference between program beginning versus 501c3 status. Yeah, so again, the three-year programming history is a requirement. It should be arts programming history. You only need to have your 501c3 status at the time of application. So the three-year programming history may have taken place before you received your 501c3 status. That's okay. The three-year programming history is used for a couple of things. One, to establish the applicant's eligibility. Like I said, in order to be eligible, the applicant has to have at least a three-year history of arts programming. And also it's used by our panel of reviewers to establish, whether or not your organization has the capacity and, has experience carrying out this type of activity in the past. There are some flexibilities, especially because of the past year with the pandemic. It doesn't have to be three consecutive years that you list. It can be just three recent years. If you have, you can include, your organization's activity from 2020, even if some of the programming was canceled, you can include that the programming as canceled, or if, you know, it had to be reimagined or, you know, changed from in-person to online, you know, any of that is okay. That's still considered arts programming. So I think that answers the question. Anything else you wanted to add, Brandon?
No, I think you did a great job. Thanks, Jenny. Can those who receive shuttered venue operating grants also apply? Yes, absolutely. If you've received other federal grants, you can still apply to American Rescue Plan grants, and that accounts for shuttered venue operating grants. It includes PPP, it includes current NEA grants in process or in the application process. And as mentioned before, the only thing you want to make sure is that you don't have any overlapping costs between those grants. You can include in your information, you know, if you're choosing to pay for facilities costs or, you know, like mortgage or expense, you can always share information about the fact that maybe SFOG is paying for salaries. And so this, you know, you can include that in your decision-making process as part of your narrative. But yeah, absolutely. As long as you're as long as you don't have any overlapping costs, you can apply to ARP.
And Brandon, just for clarity on this, because I imagine this is going to continue to surface as a question, we used to call this double dipping, right? So across federal grants, even futurearts.gov, if I apply to cover part of my salary, I cannot apply in a future grant for a project or program activity for part of my salary. Right? Like, it's not going to work that way. That's just not how this goes. We want to separate how those are being compensated are covered throughout the grant. Am I correct?
Absolutely. If you think about what the 100% of a certain line item in your budget might be, you just want to make sure that over the course of multiple grants that you're not going above that 100%. So if you're looking at a person's salary for a given year, and it might, and 25% might be covered in a previous NEA grant, you want to make sure that an ARP isn't covering more than 75% of that salary. So as long as you're not covering more than 100%, and that also accounts for, Jenny, correct me if I'm wrong, that percentage also includes any matching funds that is going towards a previous NEA budget, correct?
Yes.
Hi, I'm just going to interrupt just for 1 second, and I just want to make sure that folks understand that we will be sharing notes from this session, so answers to question, as well as a slide and a recording, because it keeps coming up in the chat. So I just wanted to address it so that we can get through other questions.
Thank you so much.
All right, so we can move on to the next question. For a three-year-old organization, can we indicate 2021's budget to further demonstrate capacity? So yeah, if you're talking about the three-year programmatic history section, you would just want to make sure you're showing as far back. So since if you're applying to the ARP grants to organizations, the part one deadline is August 12th. So you'd have to show programming going back at least to August 12th, 2018. That would show a three-year history. So if your fiscal year is, you know, 2020 to 2021, then you can show, you know, some of your 2021 activity. Or if you wanted to, include, you know, a very brief, blurb about it in your narrative, I think that would be fine too. Anything you wanted to add, Brandon?
Nope. That sounds great. Let's see here. We were told that arts organizations could apply through state subgranting orgs as well as ARP funds through the NEA. Can you clarify? Sure. So, you know, you should, as Ra had mentioned earlier, in April, we distributed awards to state and regional arts organizations. So certainly, you'll want to take a look at your individual the websites for your own state arts agencies to see what types of eligibility requirements they have for grants. I think it'll be different for each state. I think that the link for state arts agencies was posted earlier in the chat, if I remember seeing that. But as mentioned earlier, we can also, I think you'll also get a list of all of the chat comments. The local arts agency's application process is still in motion. And I believe that their start date for the usage of funds is December 1st of 2021. So take a look for you know, at some point we'll be, of course, announcing who has, which local arts agencies have received ARP funding from the NEA. So once we release that list of awardees, you'll be able to take a look at their websites as well to see what their eligibility requirements and grant requirements are.
All right, next question. Does the 501c3 requirement include organizations that are fiscally sponsored by a 501c3? So good question. The applicant on record, the applicant who submits the application must have the 501c3 designation or those other eligibility requirements, which are, you know, unit of state or local government or federally recognized tribal community or tribe. But if it's a 501c3 organization, the 501c3 nonprofit organization has to be the applicant on record. We do not fund fiscal sponsors. So the applicant has to be the one carrying out the activities described in the project and be, you know, integrally involved in carrying out the activities described in the proposal.
Thanks, Jennie. And Jennie, I think this might be a question that I'm going to pass over to you. Will we be notified by grants.gov after our submission of the short form?
So, no, I don't think so. It's the applicant's responsibility to track your application, and the instructions on how to do that are in our application materials on our website. So once you submit the application through grants.gov, this is the part one of the application process, you need to make sure it's validated and track that validation through grants.gov. And that's also how you'll receive your login credentials for part two in the applicant portal.
Thanks, Jennie. And I can take the next one. A question about which alphabetical grouping to use if you have a the in front of your organizational name. Forget the and use the next word when applying. So if your organization is called the computer, I'm just, of course, just looking at my visual cue of what's in front of me, then apply under A through L if you use C as the name of your organization. I don't think this was mentioned in the presentation, but if you have a number in front of your name as well, you will want to go through A through L.
All right. Let's see. I have to refresh to the next. Brandon, do you want to take? I don't see any more, so I have to refresh my questions.
Let's see here. In part two of the grant, how do we correctly select our discipline? We are a contemporary arts org that presents visual arts, media, and multidisciplinary. So we do have, I think, descriptions of what each of the disciplines are. So you can select the groupings that you've traditionally applied to in the past. If you have a question, that might be helpful to reach out to the ARP hotline if you need to dive into that. I think for CARES Act, if I remember correctly, there was a little bit of a shift. You know, we had, especially for, you know, we Jennie and I also work with presenting in multidisciplinary organizations. Some of those have traditionally gone to dance because they're applying for mostly dance programs. And I would say think about the overall mission of your organization and how the panel would most likely review the type of work your organization does as a whole, I think is one helpful way to think about it. Because since we're not listing and describing projects, a lot of the information about the mission of your organization and your organization's history, that is gonna play a large part in how panelists will understand what your organization does. So I would say think about the primary role of your organization and maybe not necessarily who you've always gone to based upon the project types you've applied for. Jennie, would you concur with that or any other thoughts to add to that one?
Yeah, I would concur with that. And also, if, you know, this is just an example, if you're an organization, like you're a museum that mainly presents visual art, but, you know, occasionally hosts performances and other types of activities, you should focus on what you should apply to the discipline that's really the focus of your organization. So if you mainly, you know, present visual arts, then you should go with that.
Okay, I just want to take a second and note that we are at time. It's 1 o'clock. There's still, I don't know how many questions, Brandon and Jennie, we have left. It's at your discretion if we want to take an extra couple of minutes and tie this up really neatly. I think it would be useful because I think we're just a few more questions in. Are we okay?
I'm going to chime in just really quickly. I think the questions that keep appearing are about clarifying how scholarships for art residencies are to be tied to general expenses. So really, if you can all spend just a couple minutes articulating how artists stipends are part of general operating, because that's come up a couple different times. So there's still a little confusion about that.
Yeah, so just one, I think we are unable to support scholarships though, correct, Jennie? But we can support funds for artists.
So it depends on, I mean, I guess it depends on the language you're using. I mean, some artist residency programs in particular, you know, use the word scholarships, some say fellowships, some, you know, just call them stipends to artists. In general, we're not allowed to award scholarships, award funds for scholarships, but it depends on the language you're using.
And one question I thought that was really interesting, does planning count as money that you can apply for? So I think it's planning as programming, and there's also future plans or capital projects that are in place. Could you actually apply for ARP funds if you want to continue a building improvement, or you've been doing a strategic planning process, or if you were in a strategic planning process and that's your activity before you actually open, does that count? So that was loaded. I understand that.
So we can't fund capital improvement projects. And that's even goes through our traditional granting program. So one of the things that is included is that we can fund supplies for, and I think this came up in another webinar, we can fund supplies for that support COVID relief, like PPE and other types of safety precautions, but we can't necessarily fund a HEPA filter for the building or something, you know. Even in our traditional grant projects, applicants have to provide an additional information if an expense goes over $500. Is it, Jennie? I think to determine whether it's like specific to that project and not just a capital expense for the organization. So that's something that we wouldn't be able to fund, but we can certainly fund the work of individuals that are leading strategic planning processes, you know? So if there are salaries that are included in that, that is certainly something that we can support. Or a contracted individual who is coming in and is part of the health of the individual who is leading a strategic planning process. So we can support that as well.
Got it. Well, I think we're at time, and surely we knew we wouldn't get to every question, but I'm gonna ask that this group take advantage of the ARP helpline, get very specific and clear on your questions. You have a lot to think about, so you wanna be specific in that questioning. I'm also gonna encourage you all to revisit the Alliance of Artist Communities last blog post that we put up around the 5 pillars of a healthy residency. I'm hearing a lot of questions that point to identity, program design, fund development, stewardship, and how do you actually operationalize that? We gave you some lead-ins on that. We're happy we'll be launching a tool for that, but you have to get clear on your mission and your why you're doing the work. So this is one of these things that if you're going to want to be eligible for support, you have a one-time, one-shot, one lane to get into. You need to be very clear about who you are, what you do, and your purpose for doing it, and what exactly do you need to actually make that happen. right? So this relationship is knitted throughout this. We're here to support you. We are very excited to continue on this journey with National Endowment for the Arts. We're excited to be your service organization and provide questions and direction where possible. And I just wanna thank Brandon Gryde, Jennie Terman, and Rod Joy for giving us this time this afternoon. It has been wonderful. It's been a great learning experience for me. And I hope you have found it useful as well. But we wish you all a great day. Some of you we may see later on our Emerging Program Institute information session, but thank you again for all your work. We appreciate you and good luck with your applications.
Thank you for joining and thank you for hosting.
Thank you. Thanks all.
Thank you.